Welcome back to class. Good to see that many people are back today. So, we'll be picking up from where we left off yesterday. You'll remember that we talked about the most common commands you'll be using on Linux. So today we're continuing with a few more commands. Might be a little boring, but one thing I want to mention is that it's important that you read about these commands and practice them after the class. Use the notes and remember the commands, because these commands are what you're going to use to build shell scripts later on. So this is the whole, when you're working on a command line, you're working with commands. You're going to put commands together and mix them together to do things, to do useful things. So you need to know the commands first of all. So we'll continue with some more commands, and then we'll move into some multitasking on the shell. So let's get started. So yesterday we left off at the chmod command for changing permissions on a file. Let's go to the next command. Now the next command is called gzip. Okay, so the gzip command compresses a file. So you have a file, like a text file. Text files compress very well. Okay, text files have a lot of redundant information in them. Okay, so if you want to compress a file, you use the gzip command. So gzip uses a certain compression algorithm to make a file smaller. There are other programs like bzip2 and compress, which use different algorithms to compress a file. Now, depending on what kind of file you're compressing, some of them are slightly better than the other. But the thing about gzip is that you'll find it on every Unix system. Okay, it's ubiquitous. It's an old command. It's always there. Bzip2, you might not find it on older Unix systems. So most of the time when you want to compress a file, you probably want to use gzip. So when you run gzip and a file name, it's going to compress that file and it's going to create a new file called bigfile.dat.gz. Okay, it's going to add an extension to the file you're compressing, a .gz extension. So that means it adds this extension so that you know that file is compressed. And the corresponding command to unzip a file, to uncompress a file, is gunzip. So gunzip, and you give the name of your gzipped file, and it's going to get this file back. Now, don't be confused by the name, the zip in the name. So gzip is not like your winzip. Now, winzip is an archiver. What's an archiver? An archiver takes a bunch of files. Like suppose you have 5 files, okay, and you want to combine them into one single archive, which may or may not be compressed. Okay, so that's a winzip. Okay, that's what it does. It's an archiver. It takes files, and a number of files, and compresses them into one single file. But gzip, on the other hand, compresses only one single file. Okay, gzip can only compress one file at a time. Now suppose you want to compress a bunch of files together on Linux. This is what you'll use. You'll use tar. Now tar is a command. Tar is an archiver on Linux. What tar does is, tar doesn't compress. What tar does, it takes a number of files. So suppose you have your directory hierarchy like this. Okay. This, you have directory 1 and some files there, and directory 2 and some files, maybe a subdirectory here. Okay. So you have a directory hierarchy here. Now suppose you want to take this entire hierarchy and compress it into a single file called backup. Backup.tar. Okay? So this is what you'll use tar for. Tar is the program you use to do this. So what's a command for tar? So suppose you want to create an archive in tar. This is a command you'll use. Now tar also takes command line options just like every other command on Linux. So you remember that short options can be joined together. For example, in ls, we combine the hyphen a and hyphen ls, hyphen l options together. So tar also takes options. We've combined 3 options here. The first option is c. So c option tells tar to create an archive. So tar can create, and it can even reverse this process. So that's called extracting. So when you want to create an archive, you use the c command. The v command means verbose. What it means is that as it's doing its job, it's going to print out information about what it's doing, which file it's going to compress. Which file is going to archive. Now the F option tells tar what the name of the output file should be. Okay, so here we want backup.tar. We want home backup.tar. This is the name of the file we want output from the tar command. So once you give the F command, you have to give the name of the output file that you want. Okay? So F and the name is together. So whenever you specify the F option, the next option, the next keyword, the next argument should be the name of the output file. And the last argument, the last command line argument, is the name of the directory which you want to archive. So suppose you wanted to archive this entire hierarchy of your Unix, of your Linux file system, you would just give a slash over there, okay, the root directory. Now since we don't want to compress the root directory, we just want to compress my home directory. I'm giving slash home slash etc. So what it does is it creates, it takes this entire, it takes every subdirectory, every file in this directory and convert and puts it in this archive into a single file. Now it does not affect the files that are already there. The files will already be there. It just puts them together into a single file and archives them together. So it doesn't compress. Okay, so tar, the name tar comes from tape archive. So in the old days, you had a bunch of files on your hard disk and you wanted to back them up on tape. So before you store files on tape, you need to convert them into a single stream of bytes. Because on tape, you can't easily separate files. So what you do is you tar it. You create it into a single file and just write out the whole tar into a tape. Okay, into tape. And then you bring it back, you play it back, and then you start to get your files back. Now suppose you want your tar file to be, so the tar is your archive, we call it a tar file. Suppose you want your tar file to be compressed. In that case, you would just add the Z option to the tar command. So the Z option tells tar that after it's done archiving all your files, it's going to compress it too, using gzip. So that's the command for that. Now suppose you want to reverse the process. Suppose you want to get your files back after doing your archive. You would, instead of a C command, you would provide the X command. X stands for extract. Okay? So the X command, X, V, F, the other two command options have the same meaning. So the X, what it does is it reverses this process. It takes your tar file and just extracts it back. So when you extract an archive, you will get the exact same directory structure that you started with. So it preserves the structure of your files, means the subdirectories are there, the files within the subdirectories are there, even the permissions of the files will be preserved in a tar archive. Now in case your archive is compressed, you can use tar-x and you put the Z option back again. So this will uncompress it and then unarchive it. Now you noticed earlier that I told you that there's a gunzip command. So you can use that too for this. So you can do this in two steps. You can type gunzip. You can type gunzip and archive.tar.gz. Okay. Once you execute this, you're going to get the file archive.tar, and then you can use this command. So this one just saves a step. This command saves a step. Otherwise, you can do it in two steps. Suppose you got a really old version of tar which doesn't support uncompressing. What you would do is you would uncompress it first using gunzip, and then you would untar it. So untarring means extract.
So I can give the verbose meaning.
Okay, verbose means verbose is like the meaning of verbose means like talkative. Okay, so the it tells a program to give out as much information about what it is doing right now. So it's useful if you want to know what the program, suppose your tar archive is going to be compressing a really huge number of files and you want to know how much, whether it's actually working or whether the program is stuck. So you would give the verbose option. So during the verbose option, as each file is added to the archive, it's going to print the name of that file on the screen. So generally in Unix, so yesterday I was talking about Unix toolbox philosophy, right? There are all the small number of programs. Generally in Unix design, you find that programs are quiet. That's you'll find most of the commands in Unix are by default quiet. They don't print information unless it's an error or something that is important to the user. So the tar command by default, it doesn't print out anything. It just produces the archive and that's it. You get the prompt back. So most Unix commands are designed around that, and there's a reason for that. So but we want to see the program working, so we use the V option. But generally there are good reasons for not using the V option. It makes the program run a little faster. So, but just want to see the program working, you can use the V option.
Sure. If there is a very big file, if I want to place that file after tarring in some, suppose like a hard disk,
external hard disk. Is there a way to do that, not placing inside my computer?
Yeah, so you can transport this tape, the archive.
Itself is like huge file, like 400 GB file I am tiring, suppose I am saying.
You're archiving a 400 GB file?
File, and I want to keep it in an external hard disk. Is that possible directly?
Directly, yes. Yes, so the tape archive has a capital C option. Which tells you, so if you give the, this is a relative address, a relative path name, like we talked about yesterday. So what this does is it's going to compress this directory, it's going to produce this tar file in your same directory, in the current working directory. Now suppose you want this to be produced somewhere else. Suppose you don't have enough space on your hard disk, and you want to store it on some external. So you would give the hyphen capital C option, and you would specify another directory. Another directory. So that directory is where it's going to be compressed. Or wait a second, don't use the C command. You just give an absolute path to your, that would be better. Just give the absolute path to the, so suppose your hard drive is mounted on /mnt/external. You would give /mnt/external/home-backup.rg. So the C option is for the opposite. So suppose you're uncompressing a file and you want the uncompressed contents to be on somewhere else. Suppose you are uncompressing a file on your, untarring a file on your external hard disk, and you want the contents to be extracted into your current hard disk. In that case, you would use a -c command, because you'll notice in this command we're not telling the, we're not giving the destination. So if you want to specify the destination of the extra file, you give a -C option. Over here, you just give the path of wherever you want it to extract.
And if you don't give the F option, so what is the default line you'll see?
If you don't give the F option, it's gonna read from standard input. Standard input. So remember I talked about standard input yesterday. So standard input is by default connected to the keyboard. But in the next class, tomorrow's class, we'll be teaching you how to connect other sources to the standard input. So you can tar a file on the keyboard. So the next command is the df. What df does is it gives you a summary of how much space is being used on your hard disk. So you can just type the df command, and it's going to tell you in each partition you have how much space is used and how much space is free. So you'll be using this a bit when you're working on Linux to know how much space is on your devices. Df by default, when you run df, it's going to give you the free space and used space in bytes, which is a bit difficult to interpret. So you'll have really big numbers in bytes. So what df-h does, H stands for human, so df-h prints out the result in a human readable form. So it prints you the results in kilobytes or gigabytes or terabytes or whatever, depending on how big the number is, on how much space is left. And then there's the exit command. What the exit command does is it logs you out of the current shell session. So suppose you start a shell, you log into your shell and you want to get out. Then you type the exit command. Now the exit. The exit command also takes a command line argument. It's an integer. I'll tell you about that later. So we'll be talking about a thing called exit status. So exit also has a command line argument. So, but this is what you'll use mostly. So suppose you're on a terminal, on a console, you want to exit, you want to log out, use exit. Now head and tail are two commands. Which I use for text, for for filtering text files, for working with text files. So imagine we have a file called bankstatement.txt that has a really lot of, many lines, okay, hundreds of lines. And we want to see the first 10 lines of this file. So you would give the head command. Now you could use less command to view that file, but then it's going to print out the entire contents and you have to scroll through. So if you use the head command, by default, head prints out the first 10 lines of whatever file you're passing as an argument. And suppose you want to print more or less number of lines, you would use the n option, -n option. So if you give 15, it's going to print the first 15 lines. If you give 1, it's going to print the first line. Tail does the same thing, but at the end of the file. Tail will print the last 10 lines of the file. If you want to print more or less, use the -n command. You could use a combination of head and tail. So we'll be teaching how to combine head and tail. So you could cut off the first lines Suppose you want to get something in between. Okay, you would use head to remove the part which you would use tail to remove the part which you don't know from the beginning, and then use head to use the. Okay. But we'll be teaching how to combine commands together in the next class. DU command. So what the DU command does is, now DF command tells you how much space is there on each file system. For example, you have a hard disk with a partition on it. DF will tell you how much space is there free on that partition on a total. But suppose you want to know how much space a particular directory is utilizing on your disk. So you use the DU command. So you type DU and the name of the directory, whose summary you want, how much space it is using. It means it's like the sum of the space all the files are taking in that directory. Now this is a common option you use for DU-SH. What S does is, by default, if you type DU on a directory, it's going to print a summary of all the subdirectories. So suppose your directory has 3 subdirectories within it. It's going to print how much space this subdirectory and dive 2 and dive 1, it's going to print each one. So if you have a directory structure with a lot of subdirectories, it's going to print a lot of information. But suppose you just want a summary at the end, you just want a total, you would give the S option. Okay? S is like a short for summary. And the H option is like the same H option for DF. It prints out the result instead of bytes, it's going to print out in something which is a bit more understandable, like gigabytes or megabytes. The date command does exactly what it says. If you type the date one, you have to put the current date and time. Date also allows you to change the date, but changing the date is something that is allowed only for the root user. So you need to be the super user. The root user is called the super user. So the root user is only allowed to change the date. But if you are a normal user on a computer, you can view the date using date. Now date command has plenty of options. It allows you to print the date in several formats. Now suppose you are running some kind of a script that needs to use the current date and time in some particular format, like some ISO format where you print the most significant, like year, month, date, hour, minute, second, like that, separated by quotes. You can do that with date. You can even make your own custom format for the time. So date has a lot of options like that, but generally when you just type date, this prints the current date in your current time zone. The grep command, we'll be talking more about the grep command in tomorrow's class. What the grep command does is, it searches for a pattern. If you look at the man page, what it says is, grep says that it's going to print the lines that match a pattern. So over here, the pattern is orange, the word orange. And the file we're search working on is fruits.txt. So what grep does is it's going to look through each line of the file fruits.txt, and if any line contains the word orange in it, it's going to print out that line. So that's what grep does. It just looks, it prints out the line which contains a certain word. Now, in the band page, they say pattern and not word. So we'll be talking about patterns in the next class. What a pattern means is suppose you want to specify a word which is not, it's not literal. Like suppose you want every word which contains the word apple in it. So if you pass that to grep, it's going to print apple and even pineapple. So those will match. So if you want to search for something like suppose you want to search for suppose you have a file which contains some accounting data. Okay, and that file contains account data, and before every amount, okay, suppose that file is containing many rupee amounts, it contains the word RS and then a number dot number. So that means rupees dot paise. So suppose you want to search for all the occurrences of a currency in that file, you need to tell grep to search for the word RS followed by some numbers, followed by dot, followed by some numbers. So we can't tell exactly what numbers because we want to search for all numbers, right? So that's when you give a pattern. I'll be telling you about regular expressions in the next few classes, and you'll understand how to use those patterns, how we can search for a generalized strings. But right now, just we use a simple string, a simple word, and it's going to search for that literal word in the text.
Is it case specific?
Yes, of course. So all commands, everything in Linux is case sensitive. That means if you write grep with a capital G, it's not going to work. it's a different command. You can create another command called grep with a capital G. Everything here is case sensitive, including files, including patterns. And grep has an hyphen I option, which makes it case insensitive. So then you would find, so it would print lines with orange with a capital O or orange with a capital G. Now yesterday I was talking about that UNIX philosophy where there's a toolbox and you have one tool that does something very specific and then you have to combine all these tools together to do useful things. So I couldn't resist the temptation to print this whole list to show you how many commands are there. So this is not to overwhelm you, it's to show you that when you have each command doing something really small, something specific, you need a large number of commands to do different things. So you can see this list if you type info core utils on your terminal. You can see this list. So you can see that for the commands which are related to outputting of files, you remember cat. You remember the cat. We talked about the cat command. We'll be talking about the sort command, unique command. All these commands are there. So you can if you look at this tac command, it really shows how specific each command's job is. So what the cat command does is it reads a file and prints it out to STD out, to standard output. That's what we talked about yesterday. What tac does, it does exactly the same thing, but what it does is it prints the lines in reverse. So it's going to print the last line first and then upwards. So it does the same word, same thing as cat, but opposite. Now, right now you might not find a use for this command, but when you're combining commands into a script, that time you might feel the need for something that reverses the lines in a file or reverses its input, and then you will use tac. So a lot of commands, so the WC command actually prints out the number of lines in a file. Suppose you want to know the number of lines in a file, suppose you have a list of email addresses, you want to know how many email addresses are in it, you could open it and count it, or you could open it in a word processor and see how many lines are there. But if you just type WC-L and the name of the file, it's going to print out the number of lines. So very specific commands. You can type info correlators. You can move your cursor on any of these commands on each of these topics and hit enter and give you more information about it. Or you can just type man and the name of any of these commands and you can find out more what they do. So it's a good thing to explore these commands. You won't be using all of them all the time, but it's definitely good to know which commands exist so that when you're writing scripts, you'll have an idea of what command would be the best fit for that purpose. So that's a toolbox. So we're done with the basic commands. Now the shell on the bash shell supports history. So you'll be typing a lot of commands like cd, ls, and dir, and grep on the command line. Now suppose you want to run a command which you ran previously. You don't have to type the whole command again. You use the up arrow key to access the command. So if I press the up arrow key on this terminal, you can see that all the previous commands that I executed are there. And if you want to see the entire history of all the commands you typed, you just type history. Okay, and this is all the commands that I ran. Okay, so it's a whole list, and each particular command is numbered. So that in the later shell script, maybe it'll tell you how to run particular commands. So you can use the up arrow key to see the commands you previously ran. Now suppose you want to search, you remember that you ran a man command, for example 2004, the first list. You remember you ran a man command earlier, but you don't remember the whole command line. And you don't remember where it was. Maybe it's really high up in the history. What you could do is an incremental search. So for incremental search, you type Control R. Okay, Control R. Okay, I think it's not visible. So when you type Control R, you get this kind of prompt. The prompt changes. The prompt says reverse incremental search, and then you type each alphabet. You type the command. You type any part of the command which you remember. So I remember that the command contained the word man. So there it is. So I type man and now it's showing me that it found man and us in the history. Now suppose this is not the one that you were looking for. Suppose it was even higher up in the history, you would just put Control R again. So this is the previous man command I typed. And Control R again, And you can do this. Okay, so you saw earlier it printed some commands which had man in between. See, there's a word man in performance. So it printed out that command too. So you can use this to do a search in your previous history.
So how to come outside?
Okay. So suppose you're doing the search and you got man. Suppose you want to abort the search, you would press escape. Escape would bring that line into. So control R, man. Suppose this is the line you want, you just hit escape. So that line comes. Now you can execute that line and enter. You can even type enter over that directly. Suppose you want to abort that search. You do control G. So it aborts. Then you're back to your old command.
Ershaad, can we see the commands executed by root in history?
In the root in history. No, you can only see the commands executed by you, your account.
History doesn't take care of the root.
So if you log in as a root user, and you type history, you're going to see the commands, it's the root. So this history is actually stored in a file in your home directory. So you need permissions to read it if you want to display it. So you can't, generally you won't be able to view the history of another user. So it's just a history of what you type.
Sometimes when we are using two tabs of the terminal, then commands run in one tab doesn't show up in the history of other, are you aware of that?
Yes. So history, like I said, history, when you're typing commands on the shell, the history is actually stored in a file. So it's usually stored, so when you're typing commands, they're not immediately stored in this file. So what they do is they're kept in memory, and then when you exit the shell, those commands are stored in the file. So suppose you start two terminals, and you're typing some commands on terminal one, and they're not available in terminal two because they're not written in the file yet. What you can do is in the first terminal, you would type history hyphen A. Hyphen A means append. What it does is it flushes all your current history into the file. Okay. Now the second terminal needs to read this history back, right? So you'd use history hyphen N. Okay. I think it's history hyphen N, will check that. So see here. So the hyphen A option says append history lines from this session to the history file, and hyphen N says read all history lines that are not already read. So that's what you do. You do hyphen A in one terminal, go back to the other one to hyphen N, you get the history line. Okay, now we'll come to job control. Suppose you have a program or a command which is running for a long time on the terminal. You'll notice that on the terminal, when you type a command, until the command is complete, you're not going to get your prompt back. So you won't be able to type any other commands until the first command is completed. Right? So how do you terminate a command which is running for a long time? Suppose you don't want it to run anymore. You want it to stop. In that case, you use the control C. What control C does is, it's going to send a terminate signal to that process, whichever process you run, and it's going to stop running. So what if, I said yesterday that UNIX is multitasking, but so far what we've seen is that UNIX is more like DOS. It's like you run one command at a time, because you need the first command to finish, then you need to get your prompt back, and then only you can run the second command. So how do you do multitasking? UNIX is well known for multitasking. How do you do it on a shell? Now, nowadays you have all these GUIs which allow you to open more than one terminal. But in the original UNIX, you had maybe one or just one terminal, or maybe two. Okay. So how would you do multitasking on a single terminal? So if you wanted to run a command and get the prompt back immediately, so you suppose this command doesn't require you to input any data. Okay, it's not going to write any data to the screen. You can run that command and put it in the background. So how do you run a command in the background? You write the command and you put an ampersand. You put an ampersand after the command. So what does that is it sends this command into the background. I'll just show it to you on the terminal in a few, after a few slides. So what it does, it's going to run this command and send it to the background. The background means this command is not going to be stopping you from seeing the prompt. So as soon as you run this command, you're going to get your prompt back. And the command will be running in the background. And now that you have your prompt back, you're ready to run your next command. This will be running there in the background. So suppose you have, you can do this many times. You can run a number. So you can write a command to copy a large directory to another place. Okay, this command will take a long time. You just type your copy command and put the ampersand there. And it's going to run in the background. And then suppose you want to do something else. You want to untar a file. You can also type that and then put the ampersand. And it's doing all this in the background. While it's doing all this in the background, you can do your other stuff. You can read your files. You can edit stuff. You can do everything on the same terminal. Now suppose you want to know what are the jobs, the current background jobs that are running on your terminal. You type the jobs command. That will tell you what are the background processes that are running. So here's a small example of a jobs command output. Now you can see that there are four jobs running. All four are in the background. One of these jobs is stopped. I'll tell you about in the next slide. You can see that these three jobs, all of them have an ampersand. They're all running in the background. So this is job number 1, 2, 3, and 4. So this is how the shell keeps track of jobs. It gives them a job number, a job ID. So that job ID is 1, 2, and 3, 4. So in your current shell, the current shell is managing four processes. Out of that, one of them is stopped. Now I'll tell you what the meaning of stopped is. Now suppose you have a cp command which is running for a long time, it's copying a huge directory, and you want to terminate it. What you do is you can bring it back into the foreground. You can bring it back to the foreground. So once you bring it back to the foreground, you'll lose your prompt, like I told you earlier. You won't have the prompt again. And then you can type Control C and then kill that job. So to bring a job into the foreground, you would give the FG command and space, and you would give the job number. So if you're specifying a shell job, which we're doing right now, you would have to put a percentage sign before the job number. So percentage 2 means this job. Okay, we want to bring this job back into the foreground. So we will do FG percentage 2.
Yes, sir. In that pair, you have plus and minus 2 flags are there.
Yes, yes. So plus, what plus means, now suppose if you type the FG command without any parameter, without giving a percentage 2, which is the job it's going to bring into the foreground?
Third.
Yeah, so that's what the plus sign is. The plus sign tells you which is the default job. That FG and B, this FG command and BG command, this is the default job on which they will operate. And the minus sign tells you that if, in case you stop, you kill this job, third job, which is the next job could come in its place? Which is the next default job? That's 4. So in case, if 3 complete, suppose a 3 command completed, the next job that's going to get the plus sign is 4. And a minus sign will go to the one which I ran before that. Yeah, so yes, that's important, because if you have background jobs running, in your terminal and try to exit, if you type the exit command, usually the shell will warn you. It will say that there are background jobs running, and to not exit the first time. But if you type exit again, it's gonna come out. So it kind of warns you. What happens is when you exit a shell, so I told you the shell manages all these processes. So all these processes are actually it might be interesting to know this, but in Linux, just like a file system, processes also have a hierarchy. Every process has a child and a parent. So it's just like this. So every program, so all these programs which are running here, all these commands are actually children of your shell. They're started by the shell, so they all of their parent is the shell. So if the shell dies, if you exit the shell, they also will be terminated. So that's why the shell is warning you that there are background jobs running.
One more thing is that if you just log out, if you submit the jobs and log out, and you put up jobs, you won't be able to see the jobs which we have.
Right, right. So this is per session. This is per session. This is for one terminal only. So suppose you open a shell session now. This is all the jobs that are managed by the current session. Suppose you open another session, you won't see these jobs in that session. Because these belong to this session of the shell.
So
because
there's no way to see those which were running from before?
No.
If it is a shell script, like just doing the problems in the jobs running with, you won't be able to kill that completely.
Okay, now you're going to talk and also. You can run these programs in a way that they don't die when you exit the shell. Okay, that time they'll continue running. And in that case, you can view those commands using top yes, but they won't appear in the jobs also.
It won't appear.
Yeah, because they're not managed by that session of the shell. Okay, so what about the stopped? The stopped, one of them is stopped. Suppose you ran a command, tar, you're running tar and you're extracting really, really big files. And this tar is really running and it's running in the background, it's extracting your files, but because of the huge files you're extracting, your whole computer is getting slow. Okay, you're getting slow and you want to stop this command, but you don't want to terminate it. You want to suspend it for a while, and then when you're done with your work, when you're leaving office, you just want to resume it. In that case, what you do is you suspend the job. What you do is you bring the job into the foreground, you do FG first, bring the job into the foreground, and type Control Z. What Control Z is suspends the job. So suspending a job does not mean it's terminating. It's just going to be sort of in suspended animation, it's going to be stopped. And you can resume it. So that suppose it's a tar process, tar is reading files from the hard disk and processing and maybe even compressing it. It's going to stop doing all that, it's just going to freeze over there. So that's what the Control Z does. It's going to stop a job. And once you do Control Z on a job, this is what it's going to look like in your job's output. It's going to look like this, stopped. Now suppose you have a job which is stopped and you want to resume it, like we said later on. You just give the BG command and the name of that stopped job. So BG%3. Now suppose you want to kill a job in this without bringing it into the foreground first. You would just give kill and the job specification. This sends a termination signal to that. Job. So you can even stop jobs. I don't mean suspend, I mean actually terminate them. You can terminate jobs by using a kill command. Now next thing is environment variables. You've seen earlier that many commands accept options like ls-a-l. Okay. There are other ways you can modify. So these options, what they do, they modify the way a command works, the way a command operates. So there are other ways to modify how a command works. And one of them is shell variables. Environment variables. So environment variables is nothing but a value which is associated with the name. Okay, just a name which has a value. And when you set this name value pair in your shell, in environment variable, every command, every program you run from that session of that shell, okay, if you run from that session of shell, every program can access this, they can view this value, they can see this value. So some programs look for certain variables, look for certain environment variables with certain names. And depending on what value is stored in them, they're going to behave differently. So I'll show you the next example. So if you want to set an environment variable in the shell, this is the syntax you would use. You would use export, the name of the variable, and the value. Now when you're setting environment variables, the convention is that you use all capitals for the name. You'll generally find many commands change their behavior depending on the on environment variables which are set. In their man pages, they'll be documented, and all of them will be all caps. So use export, variable name, value. There should not be a space between the equal to. Unlike C and Fortran, Bash does not tolerate spaces in this. So you have to put the name and the value together, no spaces. Okay. Now, what's the advantage of using environment variables? Suppose you have to, suppose you're using an option like -l for some command. Every time you run that command, you'll have to use the l option if that's what you want. Now suppose there's some permanent way to set it in the shell, in the session of the shell, so that every time you run that command, it behaves in some particular way. So that's what the environment variable provides you. And we'll do this on the less command. So what does the less command do? The less command just prints out the contents of a file. Okay, this is how it works. It just prints out, this is the text file, this is its contents. If you provide less hyphen n, okay, it's gonna prepend a line number. Okay, it's just an option, just like LS, it's just an option. Now suppose you want to make this option, suppose you're the kind of person who really wants line numbers all the time. In that case, you will have to provide the hyphen n option every time you run less. The other option is you export this environment variable. You set this environment variable. You do export. This environment variable is documented in your less man page. If you look at the less man page, you can do that. You can look at the less man page. There's a section called environment variables, and this less is there in it. So if you set this less environment variable to hyphen n, now every time you run less, it's going to be as though you pass this option to it. So now you don't have to actually pass that option. You just need to run less and file. This is going to be exactly like this. I'll not show it to your account because we're running out of time, but that's what it does. So it kind of provides a session. This is valid for your entire session until you exit your shell and start again. So when you start a new shell, all your environment variables which you set are lost. Now there are ways to make it permanent.
So we have to just make the ls to temporary.
Sorry?
We are using the
aliases. Yeah, aliases. So the less command, when it runs, it searches for all the environment variables which are set in the shell. And it looks particularly for an environment variable which is named capital LESS. So if you type small LESS, it's not going to work because it's looking for that particular name. So I told you that every program that runs in the current session will be able to view all the environment variables that are set. So it's going to look for this particular name. So different programs have different names. So some programs have their name prepended to the name of the variable. They'll be searching for something, program name underscore something. Okay? And they'll be looking. So it's specific to the name. So you have to know the document. You have to read the documentation of the program of the program which you're running if you want to know which environment variables it responds to.
So I want to set two things like
Yeah, you can set it here. You'll have to put it in quotes if there's a space. Suppose you want to put hyphen n hyphen l. You'll put a quotes, hyphen n space, hyphen n close quote. You talk about quotes in the shell script. Now suppose you want to unset the environment variable, you don't want less to work with the hyphen n anymore. Just use unset less. This removes the environment variable. Now suppose you want to see all the environment variables which are set in the current session, you use env. env prints all the names, of all the environment variables. So if you take a typical shell session and type env, you're going to find a huge number of environment variables which are set. And some environment variables are really useful, like the home. It tells me where your home directory is. Okay. And there's a lot more in there. They're going up. You should use less maybe. So a lot of programs are dependent on environmental variables being set. Even the shell commands depend on environment variables. So yesterday I talked about the POSIX standard. Now all of these programs are developed by the GNU project. So I told you that the GNU project started making operating system which is like UNIX. So they made the operating system including the commands, utilities, compilers, everything. They created the whole set. But they felt that some options need not be the same as the original UNIX. So they changed it a bit. But suppose you wanted the original UNIX behavior. There's an environment variable called POSIXKCorrect which you can set. So if a program sees that this environment variable set is going to behave according to the POSIX standard, the SUS, the single unit specification. Okay, so editors. Text editors, you all must have used text editors. A text editor is where you interactively change the contents of a file. The most common example is Notepad. So what does Notepad do? You log in, you start Notepad, and you can change the contents of a text file. Now, Unix has its own, Unix has a number of text editors, and it has many text editors that behave exactly like Notepad. But there's one particular text editor which is, there are two actually. One of them is VI. It's been there since the old Unix system, since the historic Unix systems, VI has been present. Now, VI is a little different from Notepad. In fact, it's very different. So how do you work in Notepad? You open Notepad, you open a text file. How do you move? You use the arrow keys to move your cursor to the location where you want to enter or delete text. And suppose you want to highlight a piece of text, you use the mouse or maybe the keyboard, a combination of the keyboard, like shift and arrow keys. And suppose you want to enter text, you just type the text there, it's going to come there, right? That's how it works. But VI is different. VI is a modal editor. So in VI, you have two modes. You have a command mode and you have an insert mode. So when you're in the command mode, every key on your keyboard, including the normal alphabets A, B, C, they all have special meanings. They do something special. They manipulate text. Okay? For example, when you're inside the VI editor, if you type H, it's going to move the cursor to the left. If you type K, it's going to move up. Okay, L is going to move right. Okay, so instead of the arrow keys, you're going to be using these keys. Now, every other key has a important meaning. For example, if you type B moves one word to the left. Maybe it'd be better if I show you. So open up VI editor here. So this is a text file that I copied somewhere from the So I'll show you what each. So right now we're in command mode. As soon as you open a file, how do you open a file? I think you saw the command. I just typed VI. You type VI, the name of the file, and you start it. So now when you log into VI, when you start the VI editor, you're automatically in command mode. So now, I hope you can see the cursor there. Now suppose I'm pressing L, okay, it moves to the right, okay, and J moves down, K moves up, and H moves left, okay. So you're not using arrow keys. Now the arrow keys do work in VI. So this is not exactly the original VI that you'll find in a old Linux Unix system. This is called Vim. Vim is it has some more new features, but most of the key bindings are the same. Now the arrow keys do work, but in VI you should ideally be using these keys to move around. So I told you about the B key. So we got the cursor on it. So I press B, and it's going to jump one word back. Okay, one word. And W does the opposite. So you see every key on the keyboard, W, B, everything has a meaning. Okay. Now suppose you want to jump three words forward. Okay, this is something you can't do in Notepad. Suppose you want to jump three words forward. You just type 3 and W. Okay, 3W means repeat W 3 times. So you just type 3 and W. Okay, we skip 3 words. Okay. Now there's a whole you know volumes of commands which you can do in VI which allows you to make to manipulate text really quick, really fast. And although the learning curve for VI is steep, once you have learned VI, you can do a lot of editing really quickly, really faster than Notepad, because you never have to take your keys off the keyboard, take your hands off the keyboard. Everything is on the keyboard, no mouse, nothing. Okay. Now some other commands I want to tell you is suppose you want to delete a character, you use X. Okay, X would delete that character. Okay, this is the equivalent as a delete key. Suppose you type capital X, that's the same as the backspace key, capital X. Now the same thing I told you earlier, that 3W, it works here also. So suppose you want to delete the next three alphabets, type 3X. That's how it works. Now suppose you want to delete the entire line, you type DD. Okay? Got rid of the line. Now, the thing is, the sad part is you have to remember these. At least you need to remember the basic movement commands, how to move around, the J, K, L, the home keys. Okay? And you need to know how to delete. I'll be showing you how to cut and paste also, since that's very important for our work. Cutting and pasting. So I'll show you that also. But before that, suppose you made a mistake. Now you're using VI. You might make a mistake. So luckily undo is also available. Undo is just a U key. So it was U and you get the line back. Okay. So that's undo. Now if you're yeah.
Suppose I wanted to delete like 1,000 lines. So 100, can I type continuously and
yes, yes. Yeah, you can do that. Yeah.
To undo you do you have to be at a specific position to
No, no, it just undoes the last command which we should. That's 1,000 dB. That's what it does. Yes, 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 yes. I was going to say that. So control R readers. Control R will undo your undo.
Okay. If you want to undo last three commands, so 3, 2.
I don't know. Yeah, I'm not a Vim guru, but yeah, that's something you can try. Yeah, I think it works.
If we save this VI file, after that undo will not. If we are not saving up to that time.
Yes, yes, yeah. So we're going to tell you how to save the file also. Now, before that, how do you actually type in Vim? So when you type your normal keys, it's going to be doing all these great things. So how do you insert? So if you want to insert, you use the I command. Just press I. Okay, and I don't know if you can see it, but at the bottom of the screen, you can see it comes. Insert, it's not visible. 1 second. Okay, it's coming in color, so it's not visible. So what you'll see here is it's the words insert is present here at the bottom of the screen. Okay, insert. When you press I at the bottom of the screen, you'll see something like this. Insert.
Okay. Does A also work as insert?
Yes, yes. A also works as so A is a command which will insert but at the next location, wherever your cursor is. So our cursor is here. If you press A, it goes to the next cursor location and starts insert mode. So if you press I, it's gonna start insert mode wherever you are right now. Okay? Right? So A does that. So A does that. A goes to the next cursor location and starts insert mode. Now there's a capital A which goes to the end of your current line and starts insert mode. There's a lot of stuff like that. So once you press I, you're in insert mode. Now all the keys lose their special meanings. Okay, all the alphabets lose their meaning. You can type whatever you want. Now how do you get back to command mode? You want to get back to command mode, you press escape. And the insert, that insert display goes in. Now you're back into command mode. Now the original VI, didn't have a visual mode. You couldn't highlight. But at least now every Linux system is having VI, so you can highlight. So I'll show you how to highlight. So we'll use the J key to move down, and we'll use the H key to move to the beginning of this paragraph. And you press Shift V, okay, capital V. So capital V will highlight a line, a complete line. Now highlighting is on. Now in the bottom of the screen you can see visual line. Now instead of insert, it says visual line. Visual line. Okay. Now you're in visual mode. Now you can use the same keys. You can use the same keys that you use in command mode. So we use the J key to move down. So you're moving down. Now you highlight the entire paragraph. Now suppose you want to copy this paragraph. Copying in Vim is called Yank. So it's a Y key. So if you want to yank this line, you just press Y. Okay, it's going to copy it. Now it's copied. Now you want to paste it back. Now if you want to paste it, you use the P key. This P. You have to be in command mode to do this. So depending on, if you put small p, if you type just a regular P, it's going to paste whatever you copied, whatever you yanked now, it's going to paste it after the cursor. Okay, so after the cursor, it's going to paste it on this side. If you put a capital P, it's going to paste it before. So if I put a capital P here, it's going to print it on top. If I put a capital P, it's going to print it just after M. Okay. So I'll print it using capital, I'll paste it using capital P. And then we've got the new copy. Okay. Now, the D key, D stands for delete. So you can do the same thing, you can highlight section of text and press D. Now, a good thing about VI is when you use the D command, it automatically yanks it too. Okay, so, yank is automatic. So, when you do a D, whatever text you deleted is yanked. So, you can paste it again somewhere else. So, suppose we go down and you can paste it back here. So you can do that. So this I've only really scratched the surface of VI, but right now the best thing you can do to get started with VI is learn how to move around. Whatever you do in Notepad, like you move the cursor left and right, highlighting. I showed you that, and it's there in the notes. So you can even try it out once the class is over. So moving around and copying text and inserting text, deleting text. These are the basic things you need to know in VI. But then once you're done with that, there's a whole lot of things you can do. Tomorrow I'll be teaching about shell scripts and how you can use programs as filters. For example, one of the most common things, features we use in Vim is the S command. We'll be teaching sed in a few days. But I'll just show you a little preview of what you can do. So let's see. For example, the word D, suppose you want to replace the word D with something else. We put slash S. Okay. So what you do is you highlight your text. It's the bottom of the screen, so I don't think I can see it. Oh, yeah, that's so what I've done is I've executed, I'll undo this, I'll highlight the paragraph, and I'm executing this command. So this exact same syntax you'll be using the set command. So you highlight this text and you type colon, okay? Vim supports some commands, some more commands, which you don't need to, you just type colon. So you get into command mode, type colon, and there are some whole set of other commands. So Vim is not just an editor, it's a complete environment. So in Vim, you can actually write scripts which do something special. For example, in Word, you've seen that sometimes when you type TEH instead of THE, it does an auto-correction, it fixes it. You can actually write a small script in Vim that actually does that. So whenever you type a TEH, it automatically runs that script. And so in Word, you have to live with scripts which Microsoft gives you. But in VIM, you can even create your own script. So suppose there's a spelling mistake which you always make and it's not there in Word, you can always write your own script to fix that spelling mistake. So if you type colon, S, slash, and the word D, and slash capital THE in G, what this command is going to replace every occurrence of the word THE in small case with capital THE. So when you do that, you can see that this has become capital and other has also become capital because THE is there in it. Okay, and these are kind of things you can do. Suppose you have a file which has a lot of columns and you want to switch columns, you can also do that, but by using an external command. So Vim can also, you can highlight a piece of text and pass it to some external program which does something to that text and get it back. So Vim can do that. You don't have to leave the editor. So I think I've covered enough about Vim. So the best thing is practice. If you go online, you'll find things called Vim cheat sheets. You can search for Vim cheat sheets. So Vim cheat sheets are they tell you what each key does. So you can use that, open Vim and try out these keys and see what they do. So I'm telling you to look at a cheat sheet because the tutorials are usually very, very huge tutorials, and you might find it discouraging to read them. So maybe if you use a Vim cheat sheet, you can find more key combinations. Like I told you, the keys will do special things in the command line. We'll find more of them. So maybe you can try out more keys, and once you get used to Vim, you can work really fast. And Vim is like Vim is ideal for programming. So in programming, we're always we always need to cut paste and move things around and delete words. And you need to change names of variables. You're using, suppose you have a really long variable name, you can write a short variable name in every occurrence of your file, and at the end you can do a search and replace. So search and replace is what it is right now, the S command. So this is just a summary of what I showed you. The insert mode. To come out of insert mode, you type escape. So you don't need to, it's all done in the mouse. So, oh yeah, so you need to save the file before you exit out of Vim. So if you want to save the file, you type colon and W in command mode. So you come to command mode, type escape, come to command mode, type colon W. It's going to save the file. Okay? And after you save the file, you want to get out of Vim, you type colon Q. Colon Q will quit from there. Now if you want to do both in the same step, you can do colon WQ. It's going to save and exit. Now suppose you made some changes to your file and you don't want those changes to be saved, but you want to exit anyway, you would use colon Q and exclamation. Now this all looks very cryptic. It looks like a smiley, that one, but actually once you get used to it, practice is very important. You have to use these on a daily basis. Every time you need to edit a file, you just open up your Vim and do it there. And soon it becomes second nature, and you can do editing a lot faster than you would do in a Notepad, any other regular GUI editor. So no mouse, so it's fast. So I think we're out of time. So I was trying to stop with Vim. That's